Hi, let us today discuss about the inguinal canal. Inguinal canal is a musculo-aponeurotic canal situated above and parallel to the medial half of inguinal ligament. What is inguinal ligament? Inguinal ligament is a curved lower part of the external oblique muscle of the abdomen. This canal is around 4 cm in length. This canal is directed downwards, forwards and medially, and this canal extends from deep inguinal ring to the superficial inguinal ring. This canal is narrower in females, and this canal is almost horizontally straight forwards because of the poor differentiation of the anterior abdominal wall in children. Hence the chances of occurrence of hernia in female and in children are less compared to the males. And the basic contents of this canal is, in case of males it is spermatic cord, in case of females it is round ligament of uterus along with ilioinguinal nerve, which is a common content. In case of males, spermatic cord and ilioinguinal nerve. In case of females, round ligament of uterus and ilioinguinal nerve. The contents of the spermatic cord includes, vas deferens, artery to the vas deferens, testicular artery, pampiniform plexus of veins, some lymphatics, some amount of fat, genital branch of genitofemoral nerve, and sometimes very rarely suprarenal cortical tissue. All these are the contents of the spermatic cord. Spermatic cord is the content of inguinal canal, and within the spermatic cord these contents are present. Now let us talk about the boundaries. Already you know that there are, the anterior abdominal wall is made up of 8 layers. Number 1, skin. This number 1, which is the skin. Number 2, the fascia, superficial fascia. Number 3, the green one is external oblique muscle. See, this external oblique, that is the third layer of the anterior abdominal wall, is curved posteriorly and thereby forming this, as this is the inguinal ligament. The curved lowermost part of the external oblique aponeurosis is the inguinal ligament. The fourth layer, the blue one here, which is the internal oblique. Fifth layer, again the red one here, that is the transversus abdominis. Okay. And this is sixth layer, which is a fascia transversalis. And this dotted seventh layer is extraperitoneal connective tissue. And the eighth one is the parietal peritoneum. Now, this is our inguinal canal containing the spermatic cord. This black one is spermatic cord, and all those dots indicate the contents of the spermatic cord inside. And this one, it is a ilioinguinal nerve. I have shown it with red color. This is ilioinguinal nerve. Although it is a nerve, I drawn it with red. Okay, these two are the contents of this inguinal canal. This is our inguinal canal. This inguinal canal is having an anterior wall, posterior wall, roof, floor, inlet and outlet. Okay, coming to the anterior wall. Anterior wall is formed by the skin, superficial fascia, this external oblique muscle, and internal oblique muscle in its lateral one third, and more laterally the transversus abdominis. Is it clear? The anterior wall of this inguinal canal is formed by skin, superficial fascia, external oblique muscle, the internal oblique muscle in its lateral one third, and more laterally transversus abdominis. Posterior wall is formed entirely by only one structure. This is this green one, which is the fascia transversalis. This is forming the posterior wall. In its medial one third, the posterior wall is also formed by conjoint tendon. This is a conjoint tendon. which actually is formed by the fusion of these two muscles, that is the internal oblique and transversus abdominis muscle. These two muscles which forms the roof, before fusion they form the roof. Once they come onto the posterior aspect of the inguinal canal, they fuse with each other to form a tendon which is called as the conjoint tendon. So the representation of the fusion of this internal oblique and transversus abdominis, I am showing it with black color here. This represents the conjoint tendon which forms the medial 1/3 of the posterior wall. And in front of this green one, the green one is fascia transversalis. So the posterior wall entirely is formed by the fascia transversalis. In its medial 1/3, it is formed by the conjoint tendon. What is conjoint tendon? It is formed by the union of internal oblique and transversus abdominis muscle. So the anterior wall is formed by the skin, superficial fascia, external oblique muscle in its complete extent, lateral 1/3, internal oblique, and partially the transversus abdominis in its lateral most part. The posterior wall is formed in its entire extent by the fascia transversalis and its medial 1/3 by the conjoint tendon, which represents the union of internal oblique and transversus abdominis. Floor. The floor is formed by the grooved upper surface of inguinal ligament. The grooved upper surface of the inguinal ligament. That inguinal ligament is formed by the external oblique muscle. The roof is formed by the internal oblique and transversus abdominis before forming conjoint tendon. Before forming the conjoint tendon by the union of these two muscles, the roof is occupied by these two muscles independently. Now we know anterior wall, posterior wall, floor, anterior roof, and the contents in spermatic cord and ilioinguinal nerve in male. In case of female, ilioinguinal nerve and round ligament of uterus. We have two openings in the inguinal canal, that is deep inguinal ring and superficial inguinal ring. Deep inguinal ring is an oval shaped opening in the fascia transversalis. Within this fascia transversalis, we find an oval opening, that is the deep inguinal ring. From the margin of that oval opening, deep inguinal ring, internal spermatic fascia balloons into the canal. Similarly, the outlet is formed by one more opening, which is called as the superficial inguinal ring, which is a triangular opening, which is formed within the external oblique muscle of abdomen, within this external oblique muscle of abdomen. And from the margins of that superficial inguinal ring, the external spermatic fascia balloons over the spermatic cord. Is it clear now? So, deep inguinal ring and superficial inguinal ring. Let us discuss the same in the form of a paper made model. This is inguinal canal. Where I am putting my hand is the inguinal canal, which is a musculo-aponeurotic canal, because all these are the muscles and its aponeurosis, which is formed by the muscles and its aponeurosis, extending from, this is deep inguinal ring to, this is superficial inguinal ring. Is it clear? This is superficial inguinal ring. This is deep inguinal ring. The canal extends from here to here. The portion in between is the inguinal canal. This canal is lying above and parallel to medial half of inguinal ligament. Now, what is inguinal ligament? This black one you are seeing, this black one is the external oblique muscle. This is curved in its lower part. This is forming the inguinal ligament. So, the medial half of this inguinal ligament, above that the inguinal canal extends. So from here to here it is lying, the inguinal canal is lying above and parallel to medial half of inguinal ligament. Okay. Now its direction is downwards, forwards and medially in males. In children and females already I have explained it. Now coming to its boundaries in the form of model. Anteriorly it is formed by skin, fascia, complete, this black one, it is external oblique muscle in its complete extent. Then we have this yellow one, or this one, which is internal oblique muscle, which is in its lateral 1/3, and more laterally the green one here you are seeing, that is transversus abdominis. Okay, so the anterior wall is formed by skin, superficial fascia in its complete extent, external oblique muscle in its lateral 1/3, it is internal oblique muscle, and more laterally the green one, transversus abdominis. This is the posterior wall. It is entirely formed by this orange one, which is fascia transversalis. The posterior wall is formed entirely by the fascia transversalis, and in its medial 1/3, this gray one, that is the conjoint tendon. That gray one is the conjoint tendon, which is formed by the union of internal oblique and transversus abdominis. These two are not united here, and they form the roof. The arched fibers of transversus internal oblique and transversus abdominis forms the roof, and once they unite with each other, it forms the conjoint tendon, which is the which is occupying the medial part of the posterior wall of the canal, and more medially this red one, that is reflected part of inguinal ligament, that is an extension of this inguinal ligament. This black extension is this one, that is the reflected part of inguinal ligament. So the anterior wall is formed by skin, superficial fascia in its entire extent, external oblique muscle in its lateral 1/3, the internal oblique muscle in its lateral most part, the transversus abdominis. The posterior wall in its entire extent is formed by the fascia transversalis. In front of the fascia transversalis, in its medial 1/3, it is formed by this one, that is the conjoint tendon, and its medial most part, it is formed by the reflected part of inguinal ligament. The roof is formed by the arched fibers of internal oblique and transversus abdominis before forming the conjoint tendon. The floor is formed by the grooved upper surface of the inguinal ligament. The inlet is formed by the deep inguinal ring, which is an oval opening situated in the fascia transversalis, and from the margins of this deep inguinal ring, the internal spermatic fascia balloons over the spermatic cord inside. In fact, the deep inguinal ring is considered as the neck of internal spermatic fascia. This oval opening of deep inguinal ring, it lies 1.25 centimeters above the mid inguinal point, and it lies lateral to this red one. This is inferior epigastric artery. It lies about 1.25 centimeters above the mid inguinal point, and it is related in front to the internal oblique and transversus abdominis muscles. And from this deep inguinal ring, the contents of this the spermatic cord traverses in males, and in females it is the round ligament of uterus. Okay, now coming to this one, which is a superficial inguinal ring. I am passing the pen here. This superficial inguinal ring is a triangular opening. In the external oblique muscle. So this superficial opening is a triangular opening in the external oblique muscle of abdomen, and from the margins of this ring, the external spermatic fascia balloons over the spermatic cord. Okay, the base is attached to the pubic crest, and the apex is directed down upwards and laterally here. Okay, this is about the external superficial inguinal ring, and from this the spermatic cord and ilioinguinal nerve emerges out. Now let us now discuss about the defense mechanism of the inguinal canal. The inguinal canal is protected by few mechanisms like flap valve action. So due to the location of the inlet and outlet at different planes, the in increased intra-abdominal pressure, the posterior wall tries to approximate with the anterior wall, and thereby obliterating the inguinal canal, thus helps in the defense. So this is a flap valve action. Similarly, the second one, shutter mechanism. Shutter mechanism is the one, these internal oblique and transversus abdominis, they act like demi sphincters, and the roof is approximated towards the floor during increased intra abdominal pressure. Okay. And the third one I can say is the cremasteric plug or ball valve action. So during raised intra-abdominal pressure, the cremasteric muscle contracts, thereby pulling the testis upwards towards the deep inguinal superficial inguinal ring. So that is called as ball valve action. The cremaster muscle is a part of a layer of spermatic cord. It's clear, derived from the internal oblique muscle. Internal oblique muscle gives rise to cremasteric muscle and its fascia. Is it clear? Just like I have said, the fascia, deep inguinal ring, we find the internal spermatic fascia from the fascia transversalis. At the superficial inguinal ring, the external spermatic fascia. Similarly, in the middle, the cremasteric muscle and fascia, which is derived from the internal oblique muscle. And the posture adapted by the Indians in the act of raised intra-abdominal pressure, like defecation, the parturition in females itself helps in the defense of inguinal canal. So this is all about the defense mechanism of the inguinal canal. Now coming to the applied aspect. The anatomy, the knowledge of anatomy of inguinal canal is very important for you to deal with the inguinal hernias, which is a common subject today. So this inguinal hernia means any protrusion of any abdominal content through the inguinal canal is the inguinal hernia. That abdominal content can vary from a piece of omentum to a large organ, and when that abnormal content is Meckel's diverticulum, if it is passing through the inguinal canal, it is called as Litter's hernia, L-I-T-T-R-E-S, Litter's hernia. When the abnormal protruded content is Meckel's diverticulum, it is called Litter's hernia. When any abnormal content which vary from a peritoneal sac to a piece of an organ protrudes through this inguinal canal, it is called as inguinal hernia. This inguinal hernia is of two types. Herniation occurring through the deep inguinal ring is indirect hernia or oblique hernia. Is it clear? This herniation occurring through the deep inguinal ring is indirect hernia or oblique hernia. So any abnormal content, see, behind the fascia transversalis is what? Extraperitoneal connective tissue. Okay, within the extraperitoneal connective tissue only you find all the abdominal organs. So that any abnormal content, if it is protruding through this deep inguinal ring and traversing through the inguinal canal and protruding out, we call it as oblique or indirect hernia. So the neck of the hernial sac in this case lies lateral to this, what is this artery? Inferior epigastric artery. And this happens due to persistence of processus vaginalis. Processus vaginalis is an embryological derivative formed for the descent of the testis. It is just like a track or a road for the descent of the testis in the intra-abdominal life, intra-uterine life. Once the testis is descended into the scrotum, the processus vaginalis should obliterate. When instead of obliterating, if it is patent, it creates a way for other abdominal contents to protrude, provided during the acts of raised intra-abdominal pressure. Okay. So herniation occurring lateral to inferior epigastric artery, the content passing through the deep inguinal ring is indirect or oblique hernia, and it occurs due to persistence of processus vaginalis, and it is usually congenital by birth due to persistence of that processus vaginalis, and it may be unilateral it is unilateral, it is seen in young children, it is seen in young children, and all these are the features of the indirect or oblique hernia. If you see the coverings of indirect or oblique hernia, if you see, number one, from within outwards, the coverings, number one is peritoneum of the sac itself. Number two, since that content is placed in the extra peritoneal connective tissue, you can see that covering will be taken around it. So extra peritoneal connective tissue. Number three, when the content passed through this deep inguinal ring, here what fascia is present, already I have said, that is internal spermatic fascia. So the internal spermatic fascia takes its covering, that is number three. Number four, when the content passed through this inguinal canal, the cremastic muscle and fascia is, some content is rolled over it. So the number four is cremastic muscle and fascia. And number five, when it comes to this superficial inguinal ring, the external spermatic fascia. Number six, Dartos muscle of scrotum, and number seven, the skin. So from within outwards, the coverings of the herniated sac in case of indirect hernia are from within outwards. Number one, peritoneum of the sac. Number two, extra peritoneal connective tissue. Number three, internal spermatic fascia. Number four, cremastic muscle and fascia. Number five, external spermatic fascia. Number six, Dartos muscle. And number seven, the skin. So this is about the indirect hernia. Now coming to the direct hernia. So direct hernia is herniation occurring through the weakness in fascia transversalis, as well as either conjoint tendon or inguinal, reflected part of inguinal ligament. Due to the weakness of muscles forming the posterior wall, an opening may be created, and that opening, the abdominal contents may protrude inside, and that is the direct hernia. So this direct hernia is, again to say, we need to know a few things here. I'll just show it here itself. Let us think this as the lateral border of rectus abdominis muscle, and this is obliterated umbilical artery. So this portion of the posterior wall of extraperitoneal connective tissue, this region we call it as Hasselbach's triangle. It is called as Hasselbach's triangle. This Hasselbach's triangle is bounded below by inguinal ligament, laterally by inferior epigastric artery, medially by the lateral border of rectus abdominis muscle, like this, somewhat like this, and apex is directed above. So this is Hasselbach's triangle, which is bounded below by inguinal ligament, laterally by inferior epigastric artery, medially by lateral border of rectus abdominis muscle. This Hasselbach's triangle, any herniation occurring through the Hasselbach's triangle, from the Hasselbach's triangle, through the weakness in the fascia transversalis and through the weakness of conjoint tendon and reflected part of inguinal ligament, is direct hernia. So the direction of the herniated sac is, in case of indirect hernia, is downwards, forwards and medially. Whereas in the direct hernia, it is straightforward, because here from here the abdominal content may protrude through the weakness and enter straightly. So the direction is straightforwards. Here it is, in case of indirect one, it is directed downwards, forwards and medially. This direct hernia is again divided into two varieties. Is it clear? Medial variety, lateral variety. Is it clear? So this portion of Hasselbach's triangle between lateral border of rectus abdominis and this is obliterated umbilical artery is called supravesical fossa. This portion is called supravesical fossa or median inguinal fossa. It is either called supravesical fossa or median inguinal fossa, that is between lateral border of rectus abdominis and obliterated umbilical artery. Whereas this portion between obliterated umbilical artery and inferior epigastric artery is called medial inguinal fossa. This is medial inguinal fossa. This is medial inguinal fossa. And the portion lateral to the inferior epigastric artery is called lateral inguinal fossa. Is it clear? So indirect hernia occurs through the lateral inguinal fossa. Direct hernia occurs through the medial inguinal fossa. One more difference we have made it. Okay. So this direct hernia covering, if you see, this is medial herniation occurring from here. If it is going, it is medial variety. This is lateral variety. So lateral to the obliterated umbilical artery is lateral variety. Medial to the obliterated umbilical artery is the medial variety. The coverings of the herniated sac in the lateral variety we'll see now. The coverings of the herniated sac are peritoneum of the sac. This one is same. Number 2, extra peritoneal connective tissue is same. Number 3 is the point of difference. That is, the herniated sac is going through this. So it is nowhere related to internal sporotic fascia. So the number 3, instead it is fascia transversalis. Here instead of internal sporotic fascia, it is fascia transversalis. Number 4, as inside, cremastic muscle and fascia. Number 5, external sporotic fascia. Number 6, Dartos muscle. And number 7, the covering skin. Is it clear? So the coverings of the herniated sac in case of lateral variety of direct hernia from within outwards are peritoneum of the sac, extra peritoneal connective tissue, fascia transversalis, cremastic muscle and fascia, external spermatic fascia, Dartos muscle, and seventh one, the skin. Only the point of difference is, in indirect hernia it is internal spermatic fascia, in lateral direct hernia it is fascia transversalis. Coming to the medial variety, this is medial direct hernia. This is medial direct hernia. The coverings include same peritoneum of the sac, extra peritoneal connective tissue. More medial, if you see, conjoint tendon, fascia transversalis, and then the conjoint tendon. If it is more medially, it is reflected part of inguinal ligament, cremastic muscle and fascia, external spermatic fascia, the Dartos muscle of scrotum, and followed by the skin. Is it clear? So the points of difference between direct and indirect hernias lies, only the difference lies in the internal spermatic fascia, fascia transversalis, conjoint tendon, and reflected part of inguinal ligament. Clinically, an important test called ring occlusion test is very important to decide or to know whether the herniation is direct or indirect. See, any inguinal hernia, manually it can be pushed back to its position, and then we can test it like just below the this oval opening. I have said it is midinguinal point is present. So you reduce the hernia manually upwards, put your thumb across the deep inguinal ring, ask the person to cough, and see whether the herniated sac is touching the thumb or not. If it is touching the thumb, it is a lateral direct hernia. If it is not touching the thumb and it is descending downwards, it is direct hernia. Likewise, we can come to a conclusion whether it is a direct or indirect hernia. Now coming back to its the basic differences between the last part, the indirect hernia and direct hernia are: herniation occurring through lateral inguinal fossa is indirect. Herniation occurring through medial inguinal fossa is direct. Herniation occurring lateral to inferior epigastry is indirect. Herniation occurring medial to inferior epigastric artery is direct. The indirect hernia, the direction of the herniated sac passes downwards, forwards, and medially. In direct hernia, it is straight forwards. And number 4, indirect hernia is congenital. Direct hernia is acquired. Indirect hernia is forming due to the persistence of processus vaginalis, whereas direct hernia is formed due to the weakness of the posterior wall, that is the fascia transversalis, conjoint tendon, and reflected part of inguinal ligament. This is congenital. Indirect hernia is congenital, and this is acquired. This is indirect hernia is unilateral, and direct hernia is most of the times it is bilateral. So these are the basic differences between the indirect and direct hernia. Hope, I think you have understood. Thank you.